convo room, the fun room. Right? Yeah, let's do it. Alrighty. So welcome back. Thank you to Sequent for the morning tea. It was fantastic. I couldn't eat any of it, but it was really good. I ate a couple of blueberries. We are going to do a meta. Are we doing the meta digital blurb and video? Yeah, can we do that? Thank you. Awesome. Thank you to Meta Digital. And welcome, everyone, to a session that's got two iconic New Zealand companies who are going to share their journeys in the regulated dairy and banking environment. You will have read Desley's and Julian's bios. Really cool thing about both of them, they love the horse. Desley, unfortunately, loved the horse so much she fell off and... A few weeks ago, she nearly fell off her horse, but managed to get back on again and complete a horse course thing. Julian owns a lifestyle block and wife loves the horse especially. Not sure if Julian's fallen off a horse. That's probably more for him to say than me. So without further ado, we're going to do two sessions within this, 10 minutes each of each speaker. Please use the app, throw the questions in there. And without much further ado, we have Desley. Thank you.
Hi. Good morning to you all, and thanks, Hamish, for the introduction. Yes, I was going to show you a few photos up there of me falling off my horse, because my motto is, you know, if you fall off the horse, always get back on again, and I wanted to show that to you, but unfortunately, couldn't. Thank you, Canterbury Tech, for the opportunity for me to share our truly Cantabrian story on behalf of Contec Group. We all love working in the agri-tech sector, two industries that are so important to New Zealand and the world. We have a team of 37, mostly based in Christchurch. The rest is spread globally. In case you were wondering, MAGCAP stands for Milk Analysis, Data Capture and Processing. It was first released in 1974 at the request of the New Zealand dairy industry. Our first customer was a milk testing laboratory, now known as Milk Test New Zealand. Still today, MAGCAP 6 is running that laboratory, where milk from every farm in New Zealand is quality tested every day, and MAGCAP does the job for the whole of Australia as well, where it runs the national laboratory at Bureau Veritas. Today's milk for MAGCAP is not just cow's milk and its derivatives, A2, organic, whey, skim, cream, but we also have sheep, goat, and coconut milk. MAGCAP was redeveloped into the Windows environment in 1998, and then had organic growth becoming the industry standard in Australasia, now implemented across 24 countries in a highly regulated environments. Regulations cover health, government, import-export tariff subsidies, federal and state orders, to name a few. We were fortunate in New Zealand that New Zealand and Australia were world leaders in the dairy industry, and they still are. So we get to work hand in hand with industry experts on a daily basis. MAGCAP is smart milk supply chain technology, which enables optimisation of the entire milk supply chain. Our customers range from the smallest to the largest dairy companies, including those with a global footprint. It has a fully integrated and centralised database and a modular design. It allows instant access to accurate data, enables and ensures compliance with regulations. It encompasses everything you need to know about milk from the farm to the factory. It might sound simple, but it's incredibly complex and includes many modules. For example, you'll see them up there, there's scheduling, route optimization, milk quality, component testing, commingling of milk, milk swaps, farmer loans, producer hauler and third-party payments, contracts, member and share equity, web portals and mobile applications for farmers, haulers, dairy companies and third parties. Milk is an extremely perishable food, so regulations are needed to ensure the quality. We had the vision to be world leaders in milk supply chain management back in 1998. We undertook a lot of research and development into how the dairy industry operated in different markets across the globe to understand what would be required to achieve this vision. MagCap's turned into a very large system with over 5 million lines of code, pays out more than $20 billion of farmer payments annually, and manages 70 billion litres of milk. MagCap is deployed in 6 continents and 24 countries, with 4 new countries scheduled for next year. Some of our MagCap clients, a selection of clients, many of which you will be familiar with, on the back of a very successful implementation for one of the largest dairy co-ops in the USA, which is Land of Lakes, we now have new implementations commencing there as well. The USA has a very complex milk collection process, so we got to develop a lot of new functionality for this market. Within the dairy industry, our software is used by farmers, dairy companies and co-ops, haulers and milk testing laboratories. Nestlé, not surprising, is our largest client. They have the most complex food and dairy supply chain in the world. As a high-performance company, Nestlé is constantly on a sustainability drive. This means continuous optimization and innovating wherever possible. Before MagCap, at Nestlé, Nestlé had 27 disparate milk supply chain management solutions in 26 countries, and that just wasn't working well for them. Nestlé needed transparency, traceability, accuracy, and auditability in their supply chains, and they didn't have it. It could take them months to receive reports from various markets. They tried to develop a new global milk solution alongside the SAP solution. They tried hard, but eventually gave up. In 2014, they undertook extensive due diligence in their quest for a solution. MagCap at that time was installed in Jamaica at Nestlé, and it was reported back to Nestlé that this was working well for them. Nestlé had a look at MagCap, called us, and the journey began. 21 countries to date for them, and more to come. Now they can access global or individual country information at a click of a button and gain deep insights into their business. This gives them a definite competitive advantage with unprecedented business intelligence. For example, they can see how much milk has been collected at any given time, see antibiotic test results in a market, and compare results from each country against each other. MagCap is a tier one mission critical solution for Nestlé, one of two they have. We get to enhance MagCap daily for them, providing them the tools they require on their net zero journey. For example, the enhancement of our mobile apps for their staff, farmers and haulers to ensure compliance with their various strategies like ESG and corporate social responsibility strategies. Last year, Nestlé deployed MagCap and SAP into Azure. Technology made this possible, but of course technology is all about people. Like building a house, you need a solid foundation and a great design that gives you the flexibility to suit your clients' ever-changing requirements. It was a huge undertaking for us and a leap of faith from Nestlé. I'm very pleased to say that we did it well, and Nestlé awarded MagCap a CIO award for the faultless go-lives and speed of delivery. Nestlé had and continues to have an incredible return on investment with MagCap. Of course, there are many challenges along the way, a few being 24/7 support required, and MagCap needed to be highly configurable. MagCap can be in any language and currency and is currently in English, Spanish, Portuguese, Chinese, and French. Our apps need to be able to work offline as well for areas where connectivity isn't always available. There's different regulations which vary from company to company, country to country, even state to state, and also for clients who have niche markets. Their requirements are continually changing, which is what makes our work so interesting and challenging. Our secret sauce. Well, I'd say the Jade platform is the underlying technology we chose to make this all possible. We required a powerful and robust platform that could integrate with any tech stack and was scalable. Thankfully, we got that right too. And Jade continues to be developed using the latest technologies. MagCap was the first live Jade production database in the world. We have global industry knowledge. We like to say we understand milk. We embrace the challenges of the complexities. We work hard and are patient. We have a dedicated and hardworking team of staff who look after our clients. The dairy industry is resilient, and never before have they so embraced technology with a global commitment to sustainability. They have to, and they want to, and they are being held accountable. The world needs nutritious and delicious food. Dairy companies know the importance of supporting their farmers to optimise their performance, and they do. Transparency. Consumers want to know the nutritional value of what they're eating. Traceability. They want to know where it came from. Sustainability, and they want to ensure that it is being sustainably produced. Oh, sorry. And the only way to achieve all of this in an economically sustainable way is through digitisation. Okay. So the future for us. I've been around a long time. Next year we have 4 additional countries to implement and more MagCap implementations for the USA, South America, New Zealand and Australia, with new dairy factories being opened in Australia and New Zealand. We keep busy with the dairy industry, however. Another aspect of the MagCap design is that it is easy to be configured to be used in other industries like cocoa, grapes, coffee and grains. In fact, we will begin to implement MagCap at a peanut company next month. MagCap is a perfect fit for them, and it's a lot less complicated. Thank you very much for your time today. I hope you enjoyed hearing our story.
Kia ora. Hopefully that's working. Julian Downs. So Des is going to come back. I think we're going to have some questions afterwards. But where's my little clicker? All right, and to answer your question, yes, I've fallen off a horse. I think you'll find most people that have ridden a horse will have fallen off at some point. So, hey, that's life. GM of Technology at TSB, as it says, that's my title on the tin, so everything technology-based that a bank does falls under my remit. At TSB, that's what we're about, right? I think most of you, I would suggest everyone in here, banks with somebody, you have a bank, how do we focus on that customer care? TSB, it's about the community good. So we're owned by a trust organisation out of Taranaki, so that all of our profits flow back into Taranaki and actually the wider New Zealand, given we're nationwide as well. So that's our purpose, at least, if you like. One of the questions I get asked a fair bit regularly, because unashamedly I go, I'm a technologist, not a banker, why do I work at a bank? Particularly when it's a regulated environment. Why don't I go work at Microsoft, the Googles, or some other tech company? And it is about this side of things, right? So every time some person is at the foundry there buying something, they're relying on our tech. How do we make sure that's going? When some new couple are about to buy their new home, they're about to settle that, the money's moving, we've got to make sure all of that's going. So we kind of live to that purpose, put that in, and how do we bring that back to the community? So thinking about in a regulated environment. So we all live in a regulated world, and we have, in the banking space, I think you heard Des mention it a couple of times, the word compliance. And when people turn up to work in the morning and say, what are you doing today? I'm doing compliance. It's not very motivating for people. So we spend a fair bit trying to shift that and say, I haven't come to do compliance. What have I come to do? Why am I there? And I thought the best way to illustrate it would be just to talk about one of the recent case studies that we have done. So the opportunity up there, when you need to get something from a bank, you have to onboard. Okay, that's our terminology for we need to know who you are. And we need to know a lot of things about you. Why do we need to know that? So that as you're accessing money and funds happening around the world or around New Zealand, we can be reliable, we can look after it for you. But also in that, you have this legislation called anti-money laundering and financial crime, okay? Which then actually, at one point, can make it feel a little bit more invasive. We need to know a lot more about you. Where did that money come from? What are you doing with that money? Where are you moving it to? And when you come down to the heart of what that's about, you ask that question of, I don't want to be the one funding a bunch of children trafficking around the world. I don't want to be the one funding somebody that's doing terrorism. So that's at the heart of the legislation. Once you understand that, you can then go, okay, I now know the why I've got that legislation, why I've got to be compliant. Now let me think about my processes, my systems, and how I make that easy for you. If we take a compliance lens to that, then we end up kind of where this opportunity is here. We force people to go into branches because I've got to see your face, know who you are. I want to make sure I know who you are. I've got to make sure your name and address and all of those contact details are accurate. Okay, so I've got to get those all captured. I've got to scan documents, make sure that I can verify those documents. And so you end up with a team of people doing a whole bunch of manual checks just to verify and make sure we are compliant. Okay, so that was how we operated. And if I go before a whole bunch of technology, that in essence what you needed to do, right? Go back to the old school bank in your community, you had to know the banking manager, they knew who you were, there was a kind of trust relationship in there. As you scale bigger, how do I bring that and how do we bring technology to help kind of solve this process? So we went to what we call digital onboarding, okay? We put up this, and this has just gone recently, if I need to onboard you now, okay, I can send you a text message that says, here's everything you need to capture. And it takes you through a very simple flow there. Capture your address. Like we go to many websites, save my people having to type the address in and spell Kiritawhiti Street where I live wrong. Just type it in there, you do that, you get it right. If I've got the customer entering the data, then I'm not going to get errors on it. Therefore, I'm going to be compliant. I'm going to have that data all uploaded correctly. And I'll guarantee almost everybody in here has a mobile phone as well. So nice and easy. If I'm now trying to onboard you for your new home loan, I don't have to get you to go into the branch in Christchurch, or maybe you're down in Otago and you've got to drive all the way up to the branch. That's a pain. Well, you've got to find a JP to verify it. I can now send you a text, get that done digitally. Additional to that, we then capture your IDs, be that your driver's license, your passport, whatever identification you've got that verifies who you are. Capture a photo actually of you, who you are. So it goes through that little lovely selfie, smile at the camera, all of those good things that you do on your phone, and then shows you that data as well and allows you to agree to it. All of this done is moved and said, you're in control. I don't now have to force you to come and follow a bank process. Customers are all in control of what they're doing on a digital space, making sure the data is accurate and all those pieces that we need to verify who you are all get accurately captured. In the background, that is also then connecting through a bunch of APIs to a whole bunch of public and non-public information to verify that information about everybody. We all know Big Brother's watching us to a degree. At one level, there's some databases out there. So you connect them with a bunch of those and say, yeah, that driver's license is valid. Okay? There's a bunch of fraud checking that goes on through various systems. Jade Third Eye, one of the ones that we have, and it goes and checks and says, okay, is there anything there? Do they come from a terrorist organisation or terrorist country? All of those regulations that exist all happen in the background while you're doing all of that. Oh, there's the face verification where you smile and I think we've all seen it as we've done our passports or something on that as well. What that then does is now throws it all back to a screen for all of our frontline people at the branches, across our call centres, etc., that now have a visual identification of you. They have all of that, so they've got a picture of what you look like. All of your data is accurate and correct. And when we're talking about compliance from our side of things, data is gold. I've got to have that valid, correct, because I'm using that to verify everything, to check. When you wander in to take money out, do a new loan, do whatever you happen to do with a bank, we're checking against that data, which is why that data needs to be checked. It needs to be 100%. And you'll see on the right-hand side, we've got this compliance process thing. So that's all about how do we make sure we know where we are. As I said, the process before we started this, that forced you to come into a branch. So you could be anywhere from 2 weeks to a month before you actually got onboarded and were then able to go transact, go buy your coffee, have your home loan going, etc. Right? Not a really good experience from you. Now we've got that down to that process kind of minutes. There's about 2 or 3 days all up to get you onboarded, have your account, and then be able to transact and do what you need to be doing. All within the appropriate regulations that we've got. Remember, when you're doing that, we're responsible for checking that whoever's there as the money comes in, all of those things, they're not doing that child trafficking, they're not doing all of those things. That's what is expected of us from the regulations, while at the same time making sure we keep all of your money, all of those things safe. So we kind of now have moved. What it also enables us to do is scale across the country. Taranaki Savings Banks, our head office is in Taranaki, but we go right across the country now. I'm not forcing people to come into branches. I'm not forcing people to go out of their way in order to interact with us. So that's the advantage that technology's driven for us. Bringing about how do you grab all of those common data, API services that might sit there. In the banking world, we talk about embedded finance, right? So I caught an Uber coming here. That payment activity just is connected with us. The data is connected. There's an interaction from Uber through to the bank account to move the money and go. That's what we're looking at as we kind of transform how we at TSB embrace a lot more digital stuff. But my key kind of takeaways from it when I'm thinking about a regulated environment, if you ever end up in that, and we all do, focus on your customer experience. Don't focus on being compliant. Compliance should just be something out the end of the day. Focus on that data accuracy, because that is 100%. When somebody's coming to check that I've been compliant, that data accuracy is there. And there's a whole bunch of tech tools that you can use that help you do that. We have what we call compliant by design. So as we're building, designing things, we're regularly checking those compliance things as we go through. And then you want real-time data. This day and age, everything needs to be and should be real-time. I don't want to know in 3 months' time that I got somebody's address wrong and I'm sending the mail to the wrong place and they haven't seen the information they need to know, or their email address, etc., whether it be that. So just make sure all that data is regularly in real time, we know we are. And go for automation of checks. Okay, so build in, when you're building systems, all those automated checks that will actually go out, verify the data, verify that you are compliant. You can build that in code these days. So they're the kind of principles and things that we bring in. So that was my case study for you. Look at that, 6 seconds to go, bang on time. Hopefully that was useful.
Righty, thank you, Julian, Desley. That was awesome presentation, and as you say, quite a highly regulated, both the industries. And in fact, that sort of goes with the first question, and feel free to, talk over each other or do whatever. It's going to be fun. You both work in industries that are highly regulated. How do you innovate when there is such a burden of regulation that has to take priority?
From my side, you have this conflict between, or you can have a conflict between innovation and in tech, we want to be testing everything quickly. So then I just put in processes with, be it my risk and compliance teams, of how we do pilots and prototypes, right? How do I get to that test and learn with somebody? As we were putting our little case study out, we had, I think, 50 customers we wanted to get onboarded. So you put enough controls around that little piece that we are doing with a small scale to test all those regulations as you're going through it. And you just have to kind of embrace that test and learn and take your regulatory risk and legal people on that journey with you.
I suppose for us, we just have to make sure our system is flexible enough and configurable enough to be able to handle any requirements that we are asked for, because we actually develop our solution for our customers, for those industry experts, and they actually tell us what they need on a daily basis. So they tell us what needs to be in their system, and we just make sure it's there for them.
Nice, thank you very much. Question around MadCap. Does MadCap as a product develop based on customer requests for functionality, or do you develop through your own sort of research and prediction of what those customer needs might be?
It's basically, I suppose because we're dealing in a global, with global markets, we get to see all different sorts of requirements around the world. And so we'll see something that could be useful for a customer over there, or they'll tell us what they need, then we basically work out how to provide that to them. And then we'll think, oh, that could be useful for another country, or that was a problem we were trying to solve in another market, and if we did it this way and used this functionality, changed it slightly, you know, that would work for them too. So it's basically all from our customers.
Nice, thank you. Question for Julian. With the move to automate and digitise compliance steps like ID checking, did you face resistance from regulators? And if so, how did you deal with that?
I don't think we faced resistance, but again, you take your regulator on the journey with you. So we took them through, in effect, what we were doing to test and verify what was happening. I did this pilot, or just before we did the pilot, the first step I did, we put it up, and I got my tech team and basically run a hack it competition, okay, to go, can you go and break this? Can you go and fake a ID with somebody else's details, etc., and basically impersonate being somebody else? At that stage, we did actually have two providers, and that found a hole in one of them. They weren't able to fix it, so we went with the other provider as we kind of got it forward. But taking the regulator along, what you're doing to prove the new tech that is out there. Because they're naturally going, they may not be an experienced tech person, you're now doing something else, you've got to take them on the standards, the testing, the verifications that you've done, and that why. So that's just, I suppose, part of working in a regulated environment.
Nice, thank you. In terms of MadCap, what were the key factors in managing and controlling the complexity of it as, you know, your application has scaled, managing the complexity?
Having a system that's designed well, and I have to say that Jeremy Ridley, our technical director, who will be over at the Jade stand for to talk to later on if anyone would like to, he's designed the system very well so that it can be managed very well. But that's the really important thing, that the system has to be stable, it has to be resilient, and because it's very important for our clients that they can rely on it.
Absolutely. this is the last question, and it's not really a question, but Julian, I have to ask it. Can you please go and work at ASB as their app keeps crashing, mate? So nice. Look, thank you both. you don't have to answer.
I'm not going to answer one, right?
But thank you, whoever put that question in anonymously. It wasn't me, because I'm not allowed. Look, thank you both very much. It was a great insight into, again, you know, heavily regulated industries, and you've both been able to both not only innovate, but also use some great technology that's home-baked here in New Zealand, you know, Jade Technology. If anyone knows, I used to work there. Well, I had to move on. Anyway.
I'm just going to get him back. Apparently, he helped build our core system at some point, so I learned that today.
Ask me about the Christmas Day thing. But anyway, nice. Here is a nice wee present for you both.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
And, so we have now Al Archer on Exploring Connections in the Nio Marsh Theatre, which is across the way there. We're going to have Matthew Evitts from Datacom here. So please choose what room you'd like to be in. I'm going to give you 4 minutes, 15 seconds to move rooms. You can go right now. Come on.